الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم. أما بعد، أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. How are my dear students? Hope you will be fine. اور میری آپ سے یہ دعا بھی ہے کہ اللہ تعالیٰ آپ کو ہمیشہ محفوظ رکھے، ہمیشہ صحت مند رکھے اور ہر آفت سے بچائے رکھے. جیسے کہ آپ کو پتہ ہے کہ آج کل ہمارے ملک کے حالات کیسے ہیں اور ایوری ویئر از دیر از اے فیئر آف کرونا وائرس، بٹ ایز اے نوبل پروفیشن وی ول ہیو ٹو فیس دس سچویشن اینڈ وی ہیو ٹو ڈیل دیز پیشنٹس ود دس. ان دا لاسٹ لیکچر وی ہیو ڈسکسڈ two major condition of small intestine, that was tuberculosis of the intestine and the typhoid conditions involving the small intestine, and the surgical conditions and complication which results from these two conditions. Continuing further forward, we will discuss more condition which involve small intestine. Mind you that I will discuss only the surgical aspects of these diseases, because these diseases mostly have a wide spectrum of their representation and they may have some medical component in it and some other component in it. So my presentation will be only for surgical condition. With this first condition, which is most commonly faced by surgeons, both seniors and juniors, and the most common condition, very frequent condition, which is in surgical flow, is intestinal fistula. So with this, what will be the learning objective of this is to learn the different aspects of is gastrointestinal fistula. We'd like to know the definition of gastrointestinal fistula, causes of gastrointestinal fistula, various classification of gastrointestinal fistula, and how these gastrointestinal fistula presents, and what is the management protocol of this gastrointestinal fistula. Can you tell me about what is the definition of fistula? This is a big umbrella, and you know very well the definition of this fistula. A fistula is any abnormal communication between two epithelial layers. These are one epithelial and one endothelial layer. This is abnormal communication. So considering this definition, we will define intestinal fistula similarly. This is an abnormal communication between two parts of intestine, either or between intestine and any other hollow viscus inside the peritoneal cavity, or between intestine and the skin of the abdominal wall. So this will fulfill the definition of intestinal fistula. And the fistula which involves skin and intestine is called enterocutaneous fistula. And this is the most clinically evident variety of intestinal fistula. And various causes of these intestinal fistulas are mostly it is iatrogenic, resulting from surgical intervention or any condition of these patients, and sometimes it may result from the stump blowout. But this means stump blowout that, for example, we have done some operation involving the duodenum. So, how can we classify these various types of enterocutaneous fistula? These can be classified according to their anatomical locations or depending on the amount of contents which are being discharged from these fistulas. So, anatomically, these can be divided into internal varieties, external varieties are mixed, comprising of both internal and external. Internal mean that if there is communication between intestine, one part of intestine into another part of intestine, small intestine and large intestine, or there is communication between some part of intestine to a hollow viscera like colobasical fistula. Second variety is of external variety, when there is external communication between some part of the segment of the intestine with the skin. It can be stomach, it can be duodenum, it can be jejunum, it can be ileum, it can be colon. So depending upon the involvement of the internal segment of this intestine, these are called, whether it is gastrocutaneous fistula, duodenocutaneous fistula, or intestinocutaneous fistula or colocutaneous fistula. These are the varieties of intestinal fistula. Then again, second type of classification depends upon the amount of discharge from this fistula, and this can be whether there is low output from this fistula or it is in between or moderate amount of discharge, or there is high amount of discharge from this fistula. Low is called when there is amount of effluents less than 200 ml per 24 hour, which will be called low output variety of enterocutaneous fistula. And if this amount is between 200 to 500 ml, it will be called a moderate variety, and it will be labeled as high output variety when the amount will exceed 500 ml per 24 hour. Understand? What can be the consequences of the physiology of this enterocutaneous fistula? Broadly, these are due to the fluid and electrolyte imbalance, due to the malnutrition, which results from the poor intake of these patients. These can also be results due to the sepsis when initially these fluids go into the peritoneal cavity and result into peritonitis, resulting into sepsis. And if all these are not there, there can be skin irritation and excoriation because of the contact of these effluent or discharge from the intestinal lumen, resulting into the excoriation of the skin. So, how can we manage these intestinal fistula, various types of fistula? While managing these intestinal fistulas, enterocutaneous fistula, there are certain goals. And what are those goals? These are re-establishment of bowel continuity, ability to achieve oral nutrition, and closure of the fistula. Allah Ta'ala ne hame ek bilkul intact bowel diya. To hamara bhi maqsad, objective ye hai in patients pe hum phir inki continuity restore kare. Taake hum wo patient apne muh se ye kha sake aur apni naam zindagi mein. Usi surat mein hoga when you will close the fistula. This The scene depends upon various phases, which ranges from initial recognition, which is usually in the first 48 hours, then with help of certain investigation, which is in the next few days, from first week to second week, and then the scene whether we should manage these fistula conservatively or with help of some surgical approach, while with definitive management is that there should be closure, restoration of the continuity of the intestine, and then post operative period after anastomosis or closure of these fistulas. So this will lead from initial resuscitation with the help of some fluids, then control of sepsis with the help of antibiotics, and eradication or drainage of these abscesses, then managing the electrolyte imbalance with the help of provision of some deficient nutrient elements, and the control of fistula discharge, and with the help of local skin care and protection. Why should we protect the skin, and what can be the skin problems? And these can be with superficial erosion of these skins, skin excoriation resulting into the ulcers there. So how can we prevent these problems, or why these problems occurs around the fistula? Because there is increased continuous discharge from small intestine resulting into wetness of this area. There is burning pain in this content area when it will result into excoriation of the epidermis, and there is also discomfort from the resulting skin edema. The goals of skin care are to reduce or contain this effluent, and so that patient should have increased mobility and independence in its normal life. Various forms of skin barriers which are available, these are solid buffers like pectin based, different powders, paste, sprays, and wipes, which these are evident in the picture which is showing at the bottom of this slide. Various these forms are applied over this contact area of the skin on the fistula. And this picture is showing the collecting system, which is usually in the form of a ring and a collecting bag, and the interstitial contents, these are collecting in this plastic bag, which is applied around this fistula opening. How can we reduce this fistula output by restricting different hypoosmolar fluids, by encouraging electrolyte mix? Like, what do you mean by this electrolyte mix? Certain forms of foods contain different rich sources of electrolytes, like grapes fruits contains tons of potassium in its juice. So when you are intent to give potassium to the patient, you can prescribe grapefruits per root. And you can also advise anti-secretory agents, which comprises of proton pump inhibitors, metostatin, or octreotide can also be advised. And there is also anti-motility agents, which contain loperamide and codeine. Somatostatin, as you know, these are naturally occurring peptide hormones, and these are inhibitory to the gastrointestinal secretions by inhibiting gastrin and cholecystokinin, reduces splenic blood flow. So mechanism of action of this metastatin and they inhibit gastrin calcipolysis. Tocinin hormones reduces spleen blood flow, reduces rate of gastric emptying, and this also inhibit gallbladder contraction. Nutritional management plays a central role in the management of intraepithelial fistula, and this may be in the form of enteral route or parenteral route. Daily requirement for these patients are that protein requirement is 1.2 to 2 gram per day, and fluid requirement is 30 ml per kg per day, and the various requirements for sodium, potassium, magnesium, and calcium are there. Sodium is 70 to 100 milliequivalent per day, potassium 70 to 100 milliequivalent per day, magnesium 15 to 20 milliequivalent per day, and calcium 10 to 20 milliequivalent per day. Enteral nutrition can also be given to the patient by placing a tube from nose either into the stomach or small intestine, and the benefits of this enteral nutrition are that it will enhance the trophic effect on the bowel, it prevents the atrophy of the small intestine, it also stimulates hepatic protein synthesis, improves immune hormonal barrier functions. This also reduces the infection rate and metabolic complication, and these are inexpensive. And the lipid-based formula absorbed more efficiently among these enteral nutrition components. And if enteral nutrition fails, we'll have to adhere with total parenteral nutrition, and it is usually advised for high output fistulas when there is gastrointestinal intolerance with the enteral nutrition, when there are multiple unfavorable factors like patient is having ileus or obstruction, so you will have to consider total parenteral nutrition. And when you will decide for surgery, this depends upon then. Usually it is decided after a second week, and when there are unfavorable condition persisting since beginning, uncontrolled sepsis which requires urgent drainage of the sepsis, and when the general condition of the patient is very poor, which requires abscess drainage, and in case of malignancy, obviously you will have to consider early operation. So, operative approaches, which involve usually after controlling sepsis with adequate nutrition, in the form of transverse incision approach or midline incision approach, and the best form of this surgery is end-to-end anastomosis after resecting the involved portion of the intestine. With this, I will end with this intestinal condition breaking into intraepithelial fistula. Then a small discussion over diverticular disease of the small intestine. As you know, diverticula is a blind pouch, and these are the varieties which can be congenital or acquired. Congenital diverticula are those which having all three layers of the intestine, like diverticula. Acquired are usually lacking with one or two layers of the intestine, and these are mostly located in the left side of the colon, and left side of the colon, sigmoid colon is mostly affected. Regarding Meckel diverticulum, it is the most common congenital anomaly of the gastrointestinal tract. It is a true variety of diverticulum, and 60% of these contain heterotrophic mucosa. Heterotrophic mucosa means that it can contain gastric mucosa, it can contain pancreatic acini, it can contain Brunner's gland, it can contain pancreatic isolates, it can contain also colonic mucosa inside it, and various vertebral tissues can also be there.